In this module, we are going to discuss Kalecki's theory as well as Kaldor's theory of income distribution, and it aims at providing us with the necessary background so as to equip you with questions like how different factors like monopoly power, material cost, that wage material cost and wage cost, savings behavior of capitalist class and wage earners, etcetera, affect the share of entrepreneurs' income and share of workers' income. It also examines as to how degree of monopoly power has been redefined. Finally, it talks about the concept of stability of economy in the context of income distribution of factors. We will first focus on the background to the modern macro theories of distribution, and what it states is that the distribution of factor income depends on the degree of monopoly power as per the Kalecki's theorem. He suggests that there is an inverse relation between relative share of wages in gross national product and both the degree of monopoly power and the share of raw material cost relative to labor cost. Now, as far as Kaldor is concerned, he provides an alternative theory of distribution that incorporates the multiplier concepts developed by Keynes to determine the relative shares of factor income. Based on the assumption of full employment, Kaldor shows that given the constant marginal propensity to save of workers and capitalists, the share of profit depends on the ratio of investment to income. In this module, we derive and explain both the theories of Kaldor as well as Kalecki's.
After studying this module, you will learn how different factors like monopoly power, material cost, that wage cost, savings, behavior of capitalist class and wage earners, etc., affect the shares of entrepreneurs' income and share of workers' income. How degree of monopoly power is redefined. The concept of stability of economy in the context of income distribution of factors. Thus, Kalecki shows that the distribution of factors' income depends on the degree of monopoly power. He suggests that there is an inverse relation between relative share of wages in gross national product and both the degree of monopoly power and the share of raw material cost relative to labor costs. On the other hand, Kaldor provides an alternative theory of distribution that incorporates the multiplier concept developed by Keynes to determine the relative shares of factors in the income. Based on the assumption of full employment, Kaldor shows that given the constant marginal propensity to save of workers and capitalists, the share of profit depends on the ratio of investment to income.
Kalecki's theory of relative shares of labor and capital in the national income focuses on the significance of the degree of monopoly power as a variable. According to him, the relative share of laborers' income or wages in gross national product is negatively related to both the degree of market power and the ratio of raw material cost relative to labor cost. Now let's try and understand as to what is he trying to really imply in this. What it means is that look, if the degree of monopoly power is high, then in that case the share of the entrepreneur is going to be more. And when the degree of monopoly power is low, in other words the market is more competitive, market power is less, then the share of wages is going to be high. In order to show this, he uses the learner measure of the degree of monopoly power, wherein it is defined as basically P minus MC upon P, which actually shows the excess of average revenue over the marginal cost. Now, you would recall that in the case of a competitive market, perfectly competitive market, price is always equal to MR, which is equal to the MC. Now, here we are talking about a situation where the firm is determining a price which is higher than the MC. In other words, there is going to be supernormal profit, and that profit is being expressed in relation to the average revenue or the price. Now, basically, we are saying that what we are trying to imply here is that marginal cost is assumed to consider cost of labor, cost of raw material and overhead costs. He assumes that there exists idle capacity. This implies that firms shorten marginal costs. Curve is constant and parallel to the horizontal axis. And it also coincides with the shortened average variable cost curve. The amounts of profit, interest, depreciation and salaries will depend on by how much the price of product exceeds the marginal cost. The formal derivation of Kaleski's relation of factor income distribution is given in the module. Now, let's consider this as pi, average profit per unit of the product. Then we have average overhead of interest, depreciation and salaries, and we have average wages, and we have average raw material cost. The notations are all given in the module. We assume that MC is equal to OM plus WM plus YM, where OM, WM and RM represent marginal overhead costs, marginal wage costs and marginal raw material costs respectively. Price can be determined as being equal to pi A plus OA plus WA plus RA. Then P minus MC is equal to pi A, which is the profit, plus OA plus OM plus WA minus WM plus RA minus RM. Since we assume that marginal wage cost and marginal raw material cost are constant, then WA minus WM is equal to 0 and RA minus RM is equal to 0. And also assume that marginal overhead cost is negligible. Hence, we obtain P minus MC is equal to pi A plus OA. Multiplying both sides by output of the firm Y, we have Y minus Y into P minus MC is equal to pi A into Y plus OA into Y. Since from definition we know that beta is equal to P minus MC by P, then P minus MC is equal to beta P, or beta PY is equal to pi A into Y plus OA into Y. Then summing over the economy, we obtain the equation is already given to you in the module. Now denote aggregate entrepreneurial income and aggregate overhead costs in the relation as C and O respectively. We have summation of beta into P into Y is equal to C plus O. The aggregate turnover or total revenue in the Kaleski model is defined as TR is equal to summation of beta into P into Y, then beta is equal to C plus O upon TR is referred as the weighted average of the degree of monopoly in the economy. That is, beta prime measures the degree of monopoly power of the whole economy. The domestic aggregate output or national income of the economy can be written as Y is equal to C plus O plus W, where Y represents the domestic national income or output and W is the aggregate wage bill. Then the following relation can be written as C plus O is equal to W minus is equal to Y minus W. Then beta constant is equal to Y minus W upon TR, or beta constant into TR by W is equal to Y minus W divided by W. The factor W by Y is the share of wages in domestic national income. The above relation reveals that the share of wages inversely depends on the degree of monopoly power and the ratio of total turnover to aggregate wage bill. Kalesky again reformulated his theory of distribution by dropping the learner measure of degree of monopoly power. In his new model, he has defined degree of monopoly power as the ratio of average price to average cost of production, and for the economy as a whole, it is the ratio of aggregate proceeds to aggregate prime cost, that is the sum of wage costs and the material costs.
Let us now discuss in detail the Kalesky degree of monopoly theory of distribution. Kalesky developed the degree of monopoly theory of distribution. According to him, the relative share of laborers' income or wages in gross national product is negatively related to both the degree of market power and the ratio of raw material cost relative to labor costs. In order to show this, Kalesky uses the learner measure of the degree of monopoly power. It is defined as beta is equal to P minus MC by P, where P is the price per unit of product, MC denotes the marginal cost, and gamma is inverse of elasticity of demand. Marginal cost is assumed here to consider cost of labor, cost of raw materials, and overhead costs. He also assumes that there exists idle capacity. This implies that firms' short-run marginal cost curve is constant and parallel to horizontal axis, and it also coincides with the short-run average variable cost curve. The amounts of profit, interest, depreciation, and salaries depend on by how much the price of product exceeds the marginal cost. The formal derivation of Kalesky relation of factors income distribution is given below. Let us consider pi A is equal to average profit per unit of product, OA is equal to average overhead of interest, depreciation and salaries, WA average wages, RA equal to average raw material costs. Further, we assume that MC is equal to OM plus WM plus RM, where OM, WM and RM represent marginal overhead cost, marginal wage cost and marginal raw material cost respectively. Then price can be determined as P is equal to pi A plus OA plus WA plus RA. Then P minus MC is equal to pi A plus OA minus OM plus WA minus WM plus RA minus RM. Since we assume that marginal wage cost and marginal raw material cost are constant, then WA minus WM equal to 0 and RA minus RM equal to 0. And also assume that marginal overhead cost is negligible. Hence, we obtain P minus MC is equal to pi A plus OA. Multiplying both sides by output of the firm Y, we have Y into P minus MC is equal to pi A into Y plus OA into Y. Since from definition we know beta is equal to P minus MC upon P, then P minus MC is equal to beta P, or beta PY is equal to pi A into Y plus OA into Y. Then summing over the economy, we obtain summation beta PY equal to summation Y into pi A plus OA. Now denote aggregate entrepreneurial income and aggregate overhead cost in the above relation as C and O respectively. We have summation beta PY equal to C plus O. The aggregate turnover or total revenue in Kalisky model is defined as TR is equal to summation BPY. Then beta dash equal to C plus O by TR is referred as the weighted average of the degree of monopoly in the economy. That is, beta dash measures the degree of monopoly power of the whole economy. The domestic aggregate output or national income of the economy can be written as Y is equal to C plus O plus W, where Y represent domestic national income or output and W is aggregate wage bill. Then the following relation can be written as C plus O equal to Y minus W. Then beta dash is equal to Y minus W upon TR, or beta dash into TR upon W is equal to Y minus W upon W, or beta dash into TR by W equal to Y by W minus 1, or Y by W equal to 1 plus beta dash into TR by W, or W by Y equal to 1 by 1 plus beta dash into TR by W. The factor W by Y is the share of wages in domestic national income. The above relation reveals that the share of wages inversely depend on the degree of monopoly power and the ratio of total turnover to aggregate wage bill. Thus, Kalisky again reformulated his theory of distribution by dropping the learner measure of degree of monopoly power. Kalisky in his new model defined degree of monopoly power of a single firm as the ratio of average price to average cost of production and for the economy as a whole, it is the ratio of aggregate proceeds to aggregate prime cost, that is, sum of wage cost and material cost. Kalski's reformulated theory of distribution can be stated as A is equal to W plus M plus O plus P, where A is equal to aggregate proceeds or sales revenue, W equal to aggregate wage bill, M equal to aggregate raw material cost, O equal to aggregate overhead cost, P equal to aggregate profit. Kalski redefines the degree of monopoly power by taking ratio of aggregate proceeds to aggregate prime cost. This is denoted as K is equal to A by W plus M, since A is equal to W plus M plus O plus P. We can write A upon W plus M into W plus M equal to W plus M plus O plus P, or K into W plus M minus W plus M is equal to O plus P, or K minus 1 into W plus M equal to O plus P. Now adding total wage bill on both sides, we can obtain O plus P plus W is equal to K minus 1 into W plus M plus W. Then W is equal to W upon W plus K minus 1 into W plus M, where W denotes the share of wages in the value added of the industry. W is equal to 1 by 1 plus K minus 1 into 1 plus MYW. By denoting MYW as J, Kalski reaches at W is equal to 1 by 1 plus K minus 1 into 1 plus J. The above relation clearly reveals that the relative share of wages in the value added depends on the degree of monopoly power K and the ratio of material cost to total wage bill J. For a given value of J, the higher the value of K, the lower will be the relative share of wages.
Now we'll take up Kaldor's theory of income distribution and see as to how this is different from the Kalski's theory. By using the concept of Keynesian multiplier, multiplier concept, Kaldor determines the relative factor shares in his alternative theory of income distribution. He suggests that given marginal propensities to save of the capitalist and the workers, the share of profit depends on the ratio of investment to income. In Kaldor's theory, the economy is assumed to have a state of full employment for a given level of output. The income in the economy Y can be classified into two broad categories, namely wages and profit. The wages consists of income generated from manual labor as well as salaries, while profits are comprised of not only the income from entrepreneurs but also the income of property. The difference between these two income groups lies in their attitude towards consumption and savings. That is, the marginal propensity to save of wage earners is relatively far lower than that of the profit earners or the capitalist.
Let us now discuss Kaldor's theory of income distribution. By using the concept of Keynesian multiplier concept, Kaldor determines the relative factor shares in his alternative theory of income distribution. Kaldor suggests that given marginal propensities to save of capitalists and workers, the share of profit depends on the ratio of investment to income. Let SW and SPY denote aggregate savings of wage and profit earners respectively. Now the income identities can be written as Y is equal to W plus Pi, I is equal to S, S is equal to SW plus S Pi. Now for a given level of investment, the savings of both income groups are assumed to be proportionally related to their corresponding incomes. That is, the saving functions can be written as SW is equal to SW into W and S Pi is equal to S Pi into Pi. Hence, from income identities, we obtain I is equal to SW into W plus S Pi into Pi. I is equal to SW into Y minus Pi plus S Pi into Pi. Or I is equal to SW into Y plus S Pi minus SW into Pi. Or I by Y is equal to SW plus S Pi minus SW into Pi by Y, calling it as equation 1. And Pi by Y is equal to 1 by S Pi minus SW into I by Y minus SW upon S Pi minus SW, calling it as equation 2. Both the equations implies that for a given marginal propensity to saves SW and S Pi, the share of capitalist income, that is, the ratio of profit to the total income, depends on the ratio of investment to total income. In this model, the share of profit in income is invariant with the changes in the two savings propensities SW and SPI. This invariant relation, along with the assumption of full employment, also implies that aggregate demand determines the price level and money wage, and with the increase in investment causes to rise in demand, thereby leading to increase in price levels. The rise in price level will in turn raise the profit margins. On the other hand, the fall in investment and thus in aggregate demand will depress the price level and thereby cause a compensatory rise in real consumption. As the price level is assumed to be flexible, the economic system in this model attains stability at the full employment level.
When the two marginal propensities to save differ to each other, the model will operate. If the savings of the entrepreneur is less than the savings of the workers, a fall in price would cause a decline in demand and thus lead to a further fall in prices. Similarly, increase in price also have cumulative effect and will drive the system away from the stability. When savings of the entrepreneurs is greater than the savings of the workers, the stability will be achieved. The intuition behind the mechanism of stability is that at the full employment situation, when savings of the entrepreneur is greater than the savings of the workers and investment exceeds ex ante savings, the aggregate demand will increase and thereby leading to increase in prices and profit margins and also share of profit to incomes. This redistribution of income in favor of capitalists will also raise aggregate real savings. Opposite situation will arise when investment falls, leading to the aggregate demand. This will consequently decrease the price level as well as profit margin and finally the share of profit to income.
When the two marginal propensities to save differ to each other, that is SW not equal to S pi and SW less than S pi, the model will operate. If S pi less than SW, a fall in price would cause a decline in demand and thus lead to a further fall in prices. Similarly, increase in the price also have cumulative effect and will drive the system away from the stability. When S pi greater than SW, the stability will be achieved. The intuition behind the mechanism of stability is that at the full employment situation, when S pi greater than SW and investment exceeds exant saving, the aggregate demand will increase and thereby leading to increase in prices and profit margins and also share of profit to income, pi by y. This redistribution of income in favor of capitalists will also raise aggregate real savings. Opposite situation will arise when investment falls, leading to the aggregate demand. This will consequently decrease the price level as well as profit margin. And finally, the share of profit to income. The degree of stability depends on the factor 1 by S pi minus SW. This is known as coefficient of sensitivity of income distribution, as it measures the change in share of profit in income due to change in share of investment in output. When SW is equal to 0, the amount of profit equals to the amount of investment and the consumption of capitalist is then pi is equal to 1 by S pi into I. According to Kalisky, this situation implies that the earnings of capitalists depend on what capitalists spend. The share of wages, on the other hand, can be derived as, since Y is equal to W plus P, therefore W by Y is equal to 1 minus pi by Y, or W by Y is equal to 1 minus 1 upon S pi minus SW into I by Y minus SW by S pi minus SW. Now for stability of the system, we must consider the case in which S pi greater than SW. If this condition is not satisfied, one of the factor shares will become negative. It can be shown that d pi by y upon ds pi less than 0 and dw by y by dsw greater than 0. When d pi by y by ds pi less than 0 holds, it can said that the greater the capitalist spend, the higher will be their earnings. The opposite will happen for workers. The positive sign of dw by y upon dsw implies that the share of workers' income will increase if they save more. Thus, so far we have studied that Kalisky degree of monopoly theory of distribution suggests that share of wages to domestic national income inversely depends on degree of monopoly power and ratio of total revenue to wage costs, while the degree of monopoly power is measured by Lerner's index. Kalisky redefined the degree of monopoly power as the ratio of price to average unit cost, and this concept instead of learners' measure of monopoly power in order to reformulate his theory of income distribution. This reformulated theory shows that the share of wages relative to value added inversely depends on the monopoly power and the ratio of aggregate material cost to total wage bills. Kaldor provides an alternative theory by adopting the Keynesian theory of multiplier. Kaldor's model suggests that at the full employment situation and given marginal propensities to save of capitalists and wage earners, the share of profit to income is a function of the share of investment relative to income. In Kaldor's model, the stability of the system can be achieved when capitalist marginal propensity to save is greater than the worker's marginal propensity to save. The intuition behind the theory of distribution is that if capitalists spend more and save less, their share of profit relative to national income will increase, while for workers, the opposite will happen.
Now, in the end, basically, we can summarize our discussion, and all that we have tried to explain in this module is that Kaleski's degree of monopoly theory, degree of monopoly power of distribution suggests that share of wages to domestic national income inversely depends on the degree of monopoly power and ratio of total revenue to the wage cost, while the degree of monopoly power is measured by learners index. He has redefined the degree of monopoly power as the ratio of price to average unit cost and used this concept instead of learners measure of monopoly power in order to reformulate his theory of income distribution. This reformulated theory suggests that the share of wages relative to value added inversely depends on the monopoly power and the ratio of aggregate material cost to total wage bill. Kaldor provides an alternative theory by adopting the Keynesian theory of multiplier. This suggests that at the full employment situation and given marginal propensities to save of the entrepreneurs and the workers, the share of profit to income is a function of the share of investment relative to